broadcasting live. I'm helping Big Ol' Uncle Pastor David Greenish. He's still out on sabbatical. He's recovering well. He had a minor procedure, but he is doing fine. Him and Trish wants to send their love and, more importantly, send their prayers to our Titan Company Church family this morning. We will be sending out a video with him in about a week or two, or maybe the next couple of days, actually. So look forward to seeing that soon. And we just want to say, stay safe, practice social distance, and just know we're praying for you. If you have any needs, please reach out to us. We're still here to support our Titan Company Church family. Amen. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we continue to pray and worship God this Sunday morning. Father, thank you this morning that we had an opportunity to come to this place and lift up your name. We thank you for technology that gives us the opportunity to continue to reach to our Titan Company Church family. And with the word of God, with praise and worship. So, Father, we pray that you be glorified this morning. We pray that everything that we do would encourage the hearts of those who are looking and listening on Facebook. We thank you, Lord, for this day. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
you are here. And we love you, God, and we're so grateful that your love for us is never ending. It's perfect, it's pure, it's unconditional. Thank you so much.
My heart.
interesting times, but I believe the Lord's given me a word that I need to share. If you listened to last week, and if you weren't able to, it is on our Facebook page and on our YouTube page. I share a message about commas. Commas, seeing things from God's perspective. And just a recap of last week, the comma, one of the smallest part of a sentence, but it has a great deal of power. In a sentence, comma means pause and clarify the meaning. Pause and clarify the meaning. In fact, I shared a scripture out of Isaiah 59:19 that says, "So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun." And then this part of the verse, "When the enemy comes like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him." If you put the comma after the word flood, it sounds like that verse means, when the enemy comes like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. But if you put the comma here, when the enemy comes, comma, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard, the verse has a whole different meaning. So commas are very important in our language. Sometimes God uses the commas in our life to get us to pause and clarify the situation. And I encouraged everyone last week that you should think about what's your response going to be during those pauses in your life. Are you going to fret, fear, be angry, curse the situation, or are you going to just trust God that he knows what he's doing and listen for his voice to get the clarity that you need? So today I want you to consider another aspect of the comma. That maybe you could be the comma in someone's life. Maybe you're the comma that someone needs in their life. But before we go into that, I need to lay a foundation. We need to understand the goodness of God. I want to share four things about the goodness of God. One, the goodness of God demonstrates he's madly in love with me. God is madly in love with you. I know some of you thinking, how can I be madly in love? Or how can someone be madly in love with me that I can't even see? God is not ghosting you. He's eternal. He's immortal. He is invisible to our natural eye, but not to our heart and our spirit. God loves us powerfully. In fact, in John 10, verse 11, he says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." He's a good shepherd. It didn't say he's a smart shepherd, although he is. It didn't just say he's a nice shepherd, although he is. It said he's the good shepherd because everything about God toward us starts with his love and his goodness. I know that when I graduated from college, I was hoping to get this fantastic job, and I ended up working at an insurance company doing one of the most boring jobs of my entire life. And I remember thinking, God must be mad at me. I studied these 4 years hard and I didn't get my dream job. He must be mad at me. But if I would have put a comma in that spot and thought about the situation, I would have realized he just needed me to get some real life experiences in the workforce before he moved me into full-time ministry. It wasn't a mistake. He wasn't mad at me. He wasn't punishing me. He was posturing me for ministry. Joyce Meyer wrote in one of her devotionals, "The highest call on your life is to enjoy God, but you can't enjoy him if you're convinced he's upset with you. You need to have reverential fear, but you must refuse to believe any thoughts that the Lord is angry with you." The Bible does talk about the anger of God, but it only lasts a moment. And let me tell you this, most of the time, he's not angry at you. He's not mad at you. He loves you. And Israel Houghton in one of his songs says, he's not mad at you, he's madly in love with you. We are made in his image. God didn't make junk, he's not mad at you. Amen? Genesis 1:27, so the Lord God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. So he doesn't make mistakes because God is perfect. He loves you. By the way, a little sidebar. You know, every time you criticize or disapprove of an aspect of how God created you, you're imputing his creativity and authority. Every time you criticize the way God has made you, you're speaking against his creative authority in your life. Don't do that. Stop it. Look in the mirror one day and say, you did a good job, God. That would make him happy. Okay, we're back on track. Psalm 139 and verse 14 says, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. So one, God's not mad at you. He's madly in love with you. Number two, we are loved even when we are not good. And I'm glad about that. We are loved even when we're not good. Then you know the story of the children of Israel. They were oppressed by the Egyptians, and God used Moses to lead them out of captivity, and Moses strikes the sea, and the Red Sea parts, and they're walking through, millions of people are walking through the Red Sea, and the Egyptian army is chasing after them because Pharaoh changed his mind. He said, okay, I'll let you go. But they go, what have I done? They took all our money. Go get them. And so the Egyptians are chasing them, and there is a Hasidic story that tells the angels are cheering and dancing in joy. The Israelites are saved. The Egyptian army is defeated. Then one of the angels notices that God is not present. Where's God? He asks the archangel Michael. Michael tells him, God is not here because he's off by himself weeping. You see, many thousands of his children were drowned today. God loves you even when you don't do good. He loves you even when we mess up. He loves us even when we make mistakes. His love is unconditional. Number three, God isn't mad at you, but that doesn't mean he won't discipline you. God isn't mad at you, but he will still discipline you. Hebrews 12:6 says, for the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes each one he accepts as his child. If he didn't punish you, it would just mean he didn't care. But he cares, and his punishment is meant to guide us in a different direction. Author Carol McLeod said, the goodness of God is chasing you down every minute of your life on planet Earth. Think about that. The goodness of God is chasing you down every minute of your life on planet Earth. God never stops doing good to his children. The goodness of God is both eternal and perpetual. It is also not based upon how you act, but upon who he is. When you begin to understand how completely and eternally good God is, your heart will then desire to belong to him completely. God is good. I am 62, and it's probably taken me 60 years to figure this out. Because sometimes we look at God as that great big something in the sky that I can't see, and he's looking down and we're going, nope, not that. Nah, messed up here. Nah. And instead, he's covering us, hovering over us with his goodness and his love. It's taken me a long time to really understand that even when times are tough, and I bet you everyone listening to this would attest, these are hard times. Even when times are tough, if you would dial into the goodness of God, you would navigate through the hard places with a hope and a joy that is otherworldly, that is not of this world, because it's rooted in God and in his goodness and in his love. And then here's the point I wanted to make. You can be the comma in someone else's life. Because God is good, I can be an instrument of his goodness. In my own self, there is just not that much goodness. Okay? I think all of us go through seasons in our life where we just don't want to. You know what I'm saying? Especially if you have kids. Clean your room. I don't mind. I remember one time when I was a kid. I came home from school and my dad said, "Why didn't you clean your room?" Now, I was probably 7 or 6, and the day before we'd had this big lesson as a family about telling the truth. It's important to tell the truth no matter what the consequences. The truth always wins. Don't be afraid, everybody, to tell the truth. So in my head, I'm thinking, should I tell them the truth or not? I went, "Okay, I'm going to go with the truth." He said, "Why didn't you clean the room?" I went, "Because I didn't feel like it. I got a whipping." I got a whooping. Sometimes we just don't feel like it. Sometimes when we see that person across the room hurting, we're just like, "I'm hurting myself. I just don't have the energy to help you with your hurt." Sometimes, how many times have you driven down the freeway and saw people in homeless tents and you just thought, I just wish they would clean up their mess. I just don't have the energy for this. Sometimes we just don't want to. There isn't that much goodness in us. But because God is in us, we can radiate His goodness even when our flesh doesn't feel like it. God is good, so we can be an instrument of His goodness. The other day I Googled, "Why are Christians so?" That's awesome. "Why are Christians so?" You know what pops up first? "Why are Christians so hypocritical, judgmental, mean-spirited, annoying, arrogant, hateful, rude, intolerant?" I went, wow! I'm telling you, that's how the world sees us. George Bernard Shaw, Nobel Prize-winning Irish playwright, critic, and passionate socialist, said, "Christianity is a very good thing. I would like to see it tried sometime." Even he knew Christianity was a good thing, but he rarely saw it around him. In the early 1920s, E. Stanley Jones, a Methodist missionary to India, in an interview with Gandhi, asked him, "How is it possible to bring India to Christ?" Gandhi replied, "First, I would suggest that all of you Christians live more like Jesus Christ. Second, I would suggest that you practice your Christianity without adulterating it. Third, I would suggest that you put more emphasis on love, for love is the soul and center of Christianity." Everybody else has heard that our faith is rooted in love, but they don't feel it from us. So what do we need to do? We need to let the goodness of God radiate in our lives. We need to let the love of God radiate in our lives in a more whole way. If you have your Bibles out, I'd love for you to turn to Matthew chapter 5, and starting in verse 43, it says, "You have heard that it was said, 'Love your neighbor and hate your enemies.' But I say to you, love your enemies." Christ flipped the script. "But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who hurt you. Pray for those who hurt you." I know how hard that is sometimes. I know that sometimes the last thing you want to do is pray for the person who hurt your heart. If you do this, though, you will be true children of your Father in heaven. He causes the sun to rise on good people and on evil people. He sends the rain to those who do right and to those who do wrong. If you love only the people who love you, you will get no reward. Even the tax collectors do that. And if you are nice only to your friends, you are no better than other people. Even those who don't know God are nice to their friends. So you must be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now I know I'm not perfect, neither are you. And that word perfect really means to be whole, to be complete, to walk in virtue and in integrity. That word perfect means to walk in virtue and integrity. So walk in integrity, walk in virtue, like our Heavenly Father has shown us. In the early church, the Jews described their enemies as anyone who wasn't like them. We do that today all the time. In fact, in our political culture today, if you don't believe what I believe, then you must be my enemy. You're on the other side. Therefore, we can't work together. I'm going to fight against you. There are so many things that we could agree on that would help move this country forward if we focused on those things a little bit more than on the five or six things that we absolutely disagree about. But when we continue to look at the people who don't look like me, or the people who don't think like me, or the people who don't act like me as enemies, then the divide just gets wider and wider. When we operate in love, we are walking in that wholeness and integrity that word perfect means in Matthew. If most of what emanates and flows from your life is hate-filled rhetoric, then I have to ask you to ask yourself, are you really, really living a Christ-like life? Living a Christ-like life. Are you really being like Christ? If everything that spews from your life is hatred and animosity and discontent and anger, that's not the heart of the gospel. That's why people Google, why are Christians so? And the first word that comes up isn't loving or generous. It's all these other things. It's countercultural. It goes against our nature to walk in that kind of love. But that's why we needed a Savior. And that's why he came. The Bible says love, agape, make the choice. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your enemies and pray for those who hurt you. If we're going to show the world God's goodness, it won't be in the way we love those we like and who are just like us. It will be because of the way we care about our enemies and those who aren't like us. Often it isn't what we say, but how we say it. Right? Yeah. You could notice that your friend's tires are bald, and you could say something like this: "Dude, your tires are bald. You need to get some new tires. You stumble bump. You're not taking care of your car. That's just irresponsible. I love you." That don't feel like a bunch of love. Or you could say, "Hey man, I noticed that your tires are kind of going bald. Are you struggling? Can I help you? Is there anything I can do to help you? Because that's dangerous. Bald tires and this rain in the Northwest, you'll be sliding all over the place. Can I help you fix that?" That feels like love to me. Sometimes it's how you say what you need to say. John 17 and 22 said, "The glory which you have given me, I have given to them." The glory which God gave Jesus, he's given to us, so that we may be one, just as the Father and the Son are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them, even as you have loved me. We are to be rooted and grounded in God's love. Not just truth and not just our own experiences. We ought to protect and promote our unity and celebrate our unique differences. In short, while the doctrine of the church's oneness does not mean sameness among all its members, it does entail persistent seeking for practical unity and the strengthening of the bonds of peace. It takes work. It takes work to love someone who don't look and act and talk like you. It takes work. But the God that is in us is great. He's powerful. His resources are unlimited. That's why we needed a Savior. When you speak truth without grace, you're being judgmental. When you speak the truth without grace, you're being judgmental. And when you keep issuing grace without ever speaking the truth, you are enabling. Grace and truth work together. They come under the banner of God's love. If you want to be a person of integrity and virtue, then let his love be the banner of your life. Walk in truth and grace. Hold them hand in hand. And lastly, you can be the comma in someone's life. If comma means to pause and clarify the meaning, when we walk in the love and grace of God, we can be the comma in someone's life. You can share God's goodness and kindness with everyone around you. You know, when I was a teenager, we used to sing a song called, "We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord." And the last part of that song says, "And they'll know we are Christians by our love." Not by the banner I raise, not by the church I go to, not by the hat I wear on Sunday. They'll know I'm a Christian because I'm loving like God loved. I'm going to close today with a couple stories. I want to share with you one of the most powerful commas in my life. I'm a black woman in a mostly white culture. I went to mostly white schools. I grew up in New York as an elementary age kid, and our school was mostly black and Puerto Rican, and then we moved to Seattle, and my parents had the good fortune to be able to put us in a Christian school, but it was mostly white kids. And the church my dad pastored started out mostly white, and when I went to college, I went to a mostly white college. And I was around a lot of white Christians who would call me their sister in the Lord, but it didn't seem to me that they made any attempt to understand my culture and my blackness, and that was hurtful to me. I got tired of the fact that I was a black woman kept getting ignored. Christians especially would come to me and think they were complimenting me by saying, "You know, I don't see you as a black person, you're just Deborah." I am Deborah, and I claim over my life first that I'm a child of the Most High God. But he created me as a black woman, and I'm proud of that. And if you want to know me, then I hope you want to know that too. I remember when I was in college, one of my work study jobs was vacuuming our dorm, and I was vacuuming the hallway one day, and one of the students walked out and said, "Oh good, the maid is here." Really? One of my other jobs was dishing up food in the cafeteria, and one day one guy walked by and said, "Hey, Aunt Jemima." Those kind of things hurt me. I felt like it was an affront and an assault on my blackness. The biggest hurt for me in the last 5 years, 10 years, has been what I would say is the lack of effort by most Christians to try to understand how and why black folks in America feel the way we do. You may be tired of hearing about racism, but you aren't nearly as tired as black folks are of living it. So with that said, with that paradigm at work in my heart and my life, I was on staff at a church in Vancouver, and we got a new pastor, Pastor Rob. He came on staff, and he was from Texas, and that made me want to take a step back right there, because I thought, is he going to be one of those good old boys? But he wasn't anything like that. He did have the accent, but that was about where it stopped. And one day we went to one of our denominational gatherings, and we walked into the room together, and we looked around the room, and he turned and said to me, "How does it feel to be the only black person in this room?" And that was a giant comma for me, because it felt like somebody in my Christian faith finally wanted to understand me as a black person. It was a huge comma in my life. It was a huge, "Wait, Deborah, all white people who are Christians people don't care. Some do. I had begun to ignore lots of people. I kind of decided, you know, if you don't want to know about my blackness, I'm not wasting my time. I'm not casting my pearls before swine. I said it. I'm sorry. That was what I adopted. I shut down. I closed up. And when Pastor Ralph said that, it opened up a new paradigm for how I could respond to my growth. Somebody finally understood. We can be the comma in someone else's life. Recently, I had a friend of our family. She grew up on the same street. We grew up in New York City, Stebbins Avenue. And she's writing a book about that neighborhood. It was very unique. And she wrote this story about my mom. And I want to read it to you. Because my mom had an amazing way of being the comma in people's lives on a regular basis. She could say something to you that was hard to hear, but you knew it was rooted in love. And it gave you the pause you needed to rethink your position. Here's the story. This is Joan Canada writing this story. One day I decided to go over to Stebbins Avenue just to see what was going on. On that day I was standing in front of the church talking when a car came into the block and hit a little boy on a bicycle. Immediately a crowd formed around the child and an ambulance was called in. There was a lot of excitement and nervous chatter going on, most of it right over the nervous child as they waited for the police and the ambulance to arrive. "Don't touch him, don't touch him," some shouted, gesturing and wringing their hands. The little boy lay frightened and trembling on the dirty asphalt. Mrs. Greenidge, my pastor's wife, came running from her apartment over the church and swiftly made her way through the circle of people talking and standing over the child. Mrs. Greenidge immediately knelt and laid down on the asphalt next to the little boy and began to gently stroke him, verbally comforting and calming him. I couldn't hear a word, but I saw the response of the child. Now he wasn't alone. A big person, i.e. an adult, had laid down next to him, communicating with him, smiling at him. Everyone else was standing looking down on him. That image never left me. I will remember it all my life. Mrs. Greenidge went to the one hurting at the place that he was, the dirty asphalt, and brought comfort. She didn't take notice to whether the spot was clean or not, whether it was soiled her clothing or not. Her focus was him, the person, his need, and what she could do until the medical help arrived. Will you be the comma someone needs? Will you lay down on the asphalt for somebody, not caring if you're dirty? Will you get down on their level? Will you get down in their pain with them and be the love, grace, and the arms of Jesus that they need at that very moment? Will you be the comma in somebody's life? Probably can't change the whole world, but maybe I can change the air around one person near me by being Jesus in flesh, journeying their need. We're living in uncertain times right now, and I'm certain that God is still in control. There will be many opportunities for us, the Church of Jesus Christ, to help people pause, clarify, and see things from God's perspective. I'm not talking about preaching to people, but encouraging and sharing the goodness of God with others. Let's leave the preaching to the pastors. Let's lay down on the asphalt with someone and help them see they are not alone. God is with us. If you're watching this today and you're with someone in the room, I'm going to ask you to go over to them. And if you've washed your hands, would you embrace them and pray for them? Be the love that Jesus has asked us to be right now. But if you're home alone and you're watching this by yourself, the Jesus, you laid down your life for me. Thank you. Now show me how to share that love and sacrifice with those around me. Wherever I am and whatever I am doing, help me to reflect your goodness and love. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. I'm going to ask our team to come back up because we want to just share one more song with you. These are very hard times for many people. And this is the church's opportunity to step in and flip the script. Maybe one day when I Google why a Christian sow, they'll think back on 2020 and go, why are Christians so generous? Why are Christians so loving? Why are Christians so kind? Amen.